Hello, fellow mapmakers. Welcome to our live mapping session for this week. I hope you're all fine, healthy, and safe. I'm Ralf Schermann of Profanity Software, and tonight I'm going to take you on another little trip into our mapmaking software. And actually, working on one of my favorite topics in map making, so I'm pretty excited tonight. Hope you'll like what I'm doing tonight. The topic is sailing ships. As some of you may know from my Facebook presence, I'm a big fan of the Age of Sail, sailing ships in general, and games with ships and everything nautical. And tonight I want to use Campaign Cartographer to create a deck plan for a good old 18th century sailing ship. Something like this, only a little bit smaller. Let's see, the camera catch that. Okay. You may know that there's been an annual in one of the very earliest annual years in 2009, actually, that had the topic of sailing ships, and we're going to revisit that, and I want to update the style in the future and see what else can be done with it. It's never been a really a full style for map making. It was more of a big example map with some tools to allow deck plans for sailing ships, and I'm sure the style could be expanded and made more practical, and perhaps we're gonna start with that tonight a little bit. So you see one of the example maps from that style on screen, and we're gonna start afresh with a new deck plan and see what we can do. To start out, I had a good look around the web, and nowadays you can find lots of different plans for construction plans for wooden ships, mostly for modelers, also of historical interest. And here's one I found on the net, and I picked it to create the map from tonight. Oh, yeah, there's the cat coming along. So Azar, say hi to everybody. And I'm gonna take this map and use it to create our first deck plan. So I've saved this as a JPEG file, and I'll also show you how to import that into Campaign Cartographer and use it as a template for our new map. So to start out, I'm going to create a new map. And the old sailing ship templates are under the other map types. So I'm going to switch to the site settings myself, click next, and then we do have the look at that low number, Cartographer's annual 27. We are at 171 now, so it's been a long time. And click next, and here's the map size we want to decide. So first thing I need to have a general idea how large my sailing ship is gonna be, and I had a bit of a look around. This template, this file I found, I didn't actually have a scale in it, but a ship like this would be around 20 meters or 50 to 60 feet long. So 20 meters is my target size for the length of the main deck plan. So 60, I'm gonna work in feet here, and 60 feet is probably a bit too close because we've got stuff around. So let's do something. Plenty of space. We can always resize the template later and say 120 by 80 feet. So actually give it a map title at this point. Let's call it the merchant ship. The plan we have is actually a historical plan from early 18th century British merchant ship, coastal merchant ship. So that's what we're going to call it as well. And I want to go through here and change my settings a bit. The background is fine, grid, we don't need to do that at this point, but I want to enable multiple levels. Because a standard ship obviously has several decks, at least a cargo hold and a main deck, and we want to do that. And we can use this to set up several drawings at once to create these at the same size and link them together. I'm going to switch to the naming scheme. Now we don't have any something for specifically for sailing ships, but we do have the Cosmographer Starship decks, so we're going to use that as the naming scheme. And I'm going to use one main deck, and we can probably do two subdecks, one for the cargo hold, one for the bilges below. So we're going to do these as subdecks to be below the main deck. We don't need a whole drawing, that will be our main deck. And then we're going to click Finish. Now we just need to find a good place to save this. With a multi-level setup like this, Campaign Cutter will save a whole set of different maps. So merchant ship here is fine. Save this. And with multi-plans, Campaign Cutter can't zoom to the correct extents when opening the fresh map. That's why it appears so small down there on the left, but we'll just do zoom extents. And here we are. And we've got the list of decks maps here. We can already, if we click on one of the subdecks here, we'll just switch to a different map with just nothing on it yet. So we can use this to later add our different maps to the ship. Not something we're going to get around to tonight, I guess, but we'll see. What you can do, you can the deck titles here are just text entities, so you can just name them, rename them as you go. So I'm just going to do call deck one actually the main deck using the edit function down here. I'm going to change the size a little bit later, and also the gray one is the currently open plan. And subdeck 1 is going to be our cargo hold. And subdeck 2 is going to be the bilges. And for the... I could use scale to rescale the text, but what I like to do is often is just change the text size to something I can remember and can refer to later again. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to extract the properties of the main deck title here that sets the current settings to the size, and then I'm going to right click and choose change text properties, select the main deck again, press D for do it, and I can see it currently has a size of 3, so I guess 2.5 should be fine to fit it into the layer box, and that's good. So there's our main deck. I'm not going to go through all the different drawings now and rename the decks. I can always do that later when I open those or start working on those other decks. The links to those are not affected. It's just the naming here on the in the key. The file names and endings will be not be affected by renaming these titles. So next is we do need the bitmap in our map, so we can use it as a template. I could start referring back and forth between Photoshop and Campaign Cartographer and try to copy the stuff generally by eye and hand, but I'm much better off by importing the JPEG and actually tracing over the image I have. For that I'm gonna set up a new sheet just to have the template separate and be able to put an effect on it. So I'm gonna add a temp sheet and also switch to the temp layer that's already in there. And then I'm going to go up to the draw menu, draw, insert file. And here's my ship plan already saved in the correct location. Here, just as an, while we're here, you can see that those are our merchant ship deck plans, the different drawings, and then Competitive Coffer just appends the name of the layer to the file. These are the ones that are linked together. And I'm going to open the ship plan. Now, because the file is not saved within the C3 Plus program data directory, Campaign Griffer can't link to that relative to that C3 Plus directory and ask us what should we do? What should it do? Should it save the path to the image as relative to the drawing, or the absolute path? And in this case, I always recommend to use the relative path to the drawing, because then you can move the two files together and the link will not be lost. It's probably not necessary here because it's just a temporary file to trace, but it's generally good practice to use a relative path and save the two in the same folder or the template image in a folder below. So we're going to do this, and now we are going to just add this in here. Not bothering about the exact size at this moment, that's our next step. Because to trace this, I want this at the correct size, so I can already have my deck at the correct extents, length and width immediately. And so, how large is this? We can't see it directly, but as we know, we can measure distances in Campaign Cartographer. So what we are going to do is, I'm going to do info distance. See, I have my snap turned on. It's a bit impractical because the end of the deck plan here is not exactly on the snap point. So we're going to turn snap off. But to measure exactly along the length, I'm going to turn ortho on, ortho for orthogonal. That means the mouse will only move vertically or horizontally. So you can see that if I now measure from here, from the stern, then my line, measuring line, just moves back and forth or up and down, and I can't put it somewhere in a diagonal position. And I'm going to measure all the way up here to the bow. I'm not going to include the bowsprit, just the bow up here. And sorry if I'm using nautical terms, not all of them will be correct, probably, or I won't know all of them, especially not in English, but I hope it's reasonably clear what I'm referring to here. And see how long is our ship at the moment. Oh, it's 42 feet and 42.7 feet. So we're going to need to resize this to be 60 feet. That's our target size. How do we do that? Well, we do have the numerical scale command for that. And that's very handy. If we right-click this scale button, I have the non-visual scale command. I'm going to select my image. Press D for do it. And Campaign Cartographer asks me for the scale factor. And yeah, I could calculate that in my head over the calculator now, but why not let CC3 Plus do the work for me? So the final size should be 60 feet. And I know that my currently the distance that should be 60 feet is 42.69 feet. And we just put the divider symbol between those and then select scale origin, scale center. It's going to take the bow, the stern of the ship here. And there's our rescaled image. And if we measure the distance now. Well, close enough, 60 feet, with a little bit of error because I'm freely selecting the points. So we're good. This is the size our ship should be in the end. Okay, so we've got our template now here at the correct size, and we do want to use this to trace or draw the general outline of our hull first. So what I'm going to do here, I'm going to set up, or I already have set up a construction tool. I mentioned that in that previous video, and I'm going to use it again. I'm going to start by drawing in a center line for my ship, which will help me mirror stuff correctly. So if I have a look here, map construction, this is my construction tool, always in my nice bright neon green so I can see it. And I'm just going to draw here a center line where I'm going to place my ship. There we are. And then I'm going to move the image to that position. So what I do in those cases, I'm going to choose a position point on my center line for the image, and then I need to turn off auto again. Can be a bit hard to place it exactly on the center line, and I'm just going to use the on modifier or F9 and place. The only problem is I have to hit. There we are. There's my ship on the center line. Now I want to draw the outline of the hull. And I could, of course, go and draw perhaps half of it, then mirror it, combine the two paths, or try to do freehand. But as some of you may know from Cosmographer, we have that useful mirrored drawing tool, mirrored polygon drawing tool, which lets you do that in one simple go. I could set up a hull tool for this style for that, and I'll probably do that at some point. But for now, I want to draw a temporary construction line just for the hull, because I'm going to reuse that probably for other stuff. So it will be useful to have available. But I don't have a mirror drawing tool set up for the hull or for the construction line. So that's what I'm going to do now. I'm going to click on the advanced button of the drawing tools. Here's my map construction tool already selected. I'm just make a copy by clicking new, and let's call it map construction mirrored polygon, mirrored poly. There we go. Then we're going to close it, so it's actually a polygon, not a path. And from the draw method, we're going to choose mirrored polygon. And there's our mirrored drawing tool. And see how we can use that. Okay, set settings. And now I'm just going to start. I don't even need to start on the center line. I'm just going to start at the first point I'm starting the curve of the hull and not a straight line. And then you can... my mistake. I do have to start on the mirror, on the center line, of course, so the tool does know where to mirror. So we're going to click on the F9 modifier again, start here on the center line, and I want my first stretch to be exactly vertical away from the center line, so I'm going to use ortho again just for this first point. And I'll start my curve there, turn off ortho again, and now I'm just going to use the mouse and my eye follow the shape of the hole. Oops, here I'm gonna do a certain section that's absolutely straight. For that I'm gonna turn ortho again, turn it off. And as you can see, I got off where I draws the other side of the whole line at the same time, correctly mirrored. And I'm gonna stop by hitting the center line again with the on modifier. Right click to finish, and there's my outline of the hole. I can now I've got everything on the temp layer now. I should have probably have put the image on a different layer so I can hide it separately from my construction lines, and that's what I'm gonna do just now. Let's change layer, click on the image, press D for do it, right click to bring up the layer dialog, add a new layer bitmap, hide that, and there you can see the outline of my hole without the bitmap showing. But I'm gonna turn that back on again for now. And I can now use this outline to continue drawing my ship. Okay, Sue says that the sound is coming across a lot better today with the new webcam. That's good to hear. Well, yeah, I've got a little bit new setup, more professional webcam. So hopefully that makes stuff a little bit better. Good, so now how do I use the temporary polygon to create stuff like the actual hole for that? So I can show you. We're going to take a quick look at our side view or rear view. And if you take a look here, you can see that the outer hole is actually turns a little bit inward as it goes up. The widest section of the hole is where the waterline is. And so if you look from above, you'll not just see the deck itself, but a little bit of the hole around it as it bends inward. So what we're going to draw first is a bit of the actual hole, the planks outside for the ship. And for that, we're going to copy the polygon to a different sheet and turn it into our hole outline. Well, our hole itself, not the hole outline. So we're gonna right click the copy modifier, copy to sheet, choose the polygon, press D for do it, and put it on the hole sheet. Now I'm gonna switch to that and hide the temporary sheet. And now I'm going to use my old friend change to drawing tool by clicking the change properties button, change like drawing tool, right click to bring up my selection of different drawing tools. And here now I have to decide, we've already got several hole bitmap fills available. We can decide which we want to use. And this certainly could be a few more. We could use different sheet effects to make different use and shapes, use and colorizations of the wood. But for now, I'm just going to use the horizontal oak wood tool. Select our polygon, press D for do it, and there's our hole shape. Quick and easy, no extra drawing. We've just turned our polygon copy into our hole outline. Okay, so we've got that. Let's go back to our temp sheet. And what we could actually do, we could move the hole above that, or if you want to see and then still see a little bit of the hole below that, we can add a sheet effect to our temporary sheet, make it a bit transparent. And this way we can see that we've drawn the hole, but at the same time still see the bitmap. I could have, of course, made the hole transparent, of course, but then I've got to change it back at a later point when I've got the finished map with the temporary sheet. I can just simply delete that or hide it and not bother about the additional sheet effects I've added to it. Okay, so here's my ship plan again. So the next step would probably be the deck itself. So another set of plank bitmaps also in the horizontal edition, but if you take a look here a bit, then our hole shape is a little bit smaller, obviously, because we see a little bit of the hole below it, but it butts up against the end of the, or almost butts up against the end, so it's not quite exact concentric smaller copy of the outer ones. So what we can do, a bit of a copy, but then move it so it's set against the rear of the outline, and let's see how this goes. So we're gonna hide the hole sheet for the moment, so our hole doesn't get in the way. And I'm gonna make a copy of, but I want a smaller copy of the outline. And for that, I'm gonna do a, could do a scaled copy. A scaled copy looks good. Select the entity I want to copy. Best if I do it. And now I have to put in the scale factor. This is a bit of eyeballing here at the moment, but we can always redo that with better size. So let's try a tenth. The copy is 0.9 the size. And we are gonna take a point at the center line for the scaling center. There we go, and we can see the problem is, let's hide the bitmap layer for a moment so we can see that better. Straight scaling, because of the difference in height and width, in length and width of the ship, does give us a pretty nice matching smaller size at the upper and lower edge, but the front and the rear edge are much too wide for this. So we need to do we can just take this because our vertical size is already quite good. So we're just gonna do a rescaling in the horizontal direction. And so I can show you another scaling command, the non-visual scale XY command. This can scale entities separately in the Y and the X direction. So I'm going to select the new entity again, press D for do it. And I'm going to make it a bit larger again. So let's start out by just making it 5% larger. But we're keeping the Y scale, so I'm going to keep this at 1. And I'm just going to reuse the scale center I've used previously. There we go. See, the scale center was not in the center of the ship. That's why it's moved a bit around, but that's already pretty good. So what we're going to do is we're going to move this. We can use the on modifier here again. We're pretty close to the stern of the ship. we go. What we see, it's still a bit too short, probably. Let's take a look at our bitmap. Yes, you can see it's still too short here. So let's just redo this. Do it. If we do it the same size again, we'll probably be at the original size or even a bit larger. So what I'm going to do is 2% larger. And this time I'm going to choose the point here at the rear. No, now I've got. Ah, I was a bit too quick. I forgot to put in the X value. So let's do that again. Do it. 2% and 1% for the Y, and now our scaling center here at the back. And that's already pretty close. You can see here the gap is getting small, and I think we're just going to leave it at the size. That's going to be fine. Could be even more pedantic and make it even a little bit larger, but I'm fine for now with this size. So what gonna I've got the copy now. That's the outline of our actual deck. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna move this to the sheet it belongs on, and put it on the deck sheet. Now I'm switching to the deck. See the outline here, and I'm gonna use my Change Leg Draw tool again. And this time we want a deck tool. I've got the decks here, and we could use the same oak type of, but pine sounds a bit better to set the off from the whole bit color-wise as well. Use this, select the entity, press D for do it, and there's my deck. Looking nice. Wonderful. Good. So we've got our next step done, and when we show the temporary layer sheet again. We have this railing around the ship, and that's something we can quickly add by. Do we have a tool for that even? I don't think so. We've got the walls. We could put this on the bulkhead sheet. That might work. But that's certainly a tool we should set up for our new style. So let's do that. We're gonna add a new layer. Okay, we've got a quick question from Sue. If you use the Change Leg Drawing tool, does that also move it onto the right sheet and layer? It does move it on to the right layer, but it keeps the current sheet, and that's why I always switch to the sheet I want my new and on. But everything else, all the properties, including the layer, is switched to the new tool you're choosing. So I'm gonna add sheet railing down, and now I'm gonna set up a new tool, and I've got to decide what bitmap I want to use for that. I don't think I want the plank texture in there, so what I'm gonna go is just for wood tool. This looks good. So we're going to use that as the base just to have the bitmap or incorrect bitmap fill already. So selected, and we're going to call this stack railing pinewood horizontal. Sounds fine. Properties, we're going to put this on our new railing sheet and layer. See, the fill style is already selected here. And then it's, we're not gonna, oh, actually we can do use a, we could use just a line with a certain width. It's probably easier. So if we set the properties to how wide is our railing, say if it's 1 foot wide, see, we get this closed shape. We could use an auto door as an open shape if you want. We want to leave gaps. We probably want to do this anyway, and open shapes are a little bit more versatile generally. So we're going to use this open version, the path. Click OK. And then we're just going to start on one point on our hole, and then we going to use our convenient draw tool. Or actually, I should start at a different point, somewhere where I want a gap. And we can have a gap here below this. It's not going to be visible anyway. There, the railing, because this will be above it. Then we're going to use T for trace. Select the entity we want to trace. And go once around the shape, click left to end the trace, and right click to finish. And now I see I've chosen the wrong shape, obviously. I've the railing shouldn't be on the outer hull, obviously, but on the deck. So that was wrong. And I also see it's a little bit wide, so I can use that to update my tool first. Undo. Okay, why doesn't do undo? Now I'm a bit confused. Well, let's just erase it by choosing the layer. There we go. And go into our tool, and half foot might be a bit too, not wide enough. Perhaps we can make it 2/3 of a foot. Oh, that's just 0.6. That sounds good. Okay. And this time we're gonna use the inner. Oh, there, I hit the center line. That's not what I wanted, and I wanted to leave the gap, right? So let's do this here. And there's our railing. Much better. So if we hide the temporary sheet, see, that does need some sheet effects. So what do we want on this? We certainly want a little bevel to set it, might give it a bit of a 3D appearance. Let's use the lighted bevel. Bevel must be small because our railing is already not very wide. So it's only 2/3 of a foot wide. So the bevel itself could perhaps be 0.2. And let's have a look. Could be a bit smoother. Okay, even perhaps a little bit larger. 0.3. Nah, that's too large. Let's stick with the 2. And that's good. And also, a little, what I often like to add is a little bit of a glow outside, dark one, just 0 strength, 0.1 units radius. Oops, a bit larger. Good. And there's our outline. We can go now in and either make it into a polygon to close it for the moment, or we can put more gaps in for the entries in onto the deck where a gap would be in the railing. And for now, I think I'm just going to leave it at that. And there's our railing on the ship. So let's take a look what we need next. Okay, we obviously need to move our temp sheet further down because we are putting stuff above it. Here we go. And you see we've got stuff like a big hatch and here space for cargo to be obviously to be put down. We've got the masts that we need to draw. Here's an entry down into the lower areas and certain beams and hooks and rings in the railing. So there's lots of different stuff we can add. We already have from the style file, for example, a nice grill symbol. What's this section here, which we can just, does it already have the pretty much correct size? Probably needs to be a little bit smaller, yes. Put this in here. Put it on, again on the center line. I can turn on snap, but my snap grid is a bit large. I could do a smaller. See, we already have a 1 grid 4 snap in here. That's much finer than the standard one we had selected. And this way I can place this correctly on the center line. Almost our symbol is a bit not this scale 0.8, this sounds fine. And as you see, this is on a sheet that casts drop shadow because I didn't switch to the flat symbol sheet that doesn't cast a drop shadow. So I'm going to move this to the correct sheet. Oh, we've got several stuff already set up here on the template, like a place for the hatches to go. And there, it does have a little dark outline, which I want, a little blur, because it's just the vector symbol. But that's already right. Looking good. So that's stuff we can reuse from the previous annual, and what we probably also have is stuff for the masts. But these will be drawing tool. Let's have a look. Do we have masts? Or is that something missing from? We've got something for mast foot. Okay, but that's just a square. No, we don't have any round tools for the mass to set up. So let's just start with that. Because looking down on the mass, it's obviously a cross section of through the mass. We'll just put in a black circle on that. We have got a layer. And we do have a sheet for that. And while we're at it, we can just add a drawing tool for that, so we don't have to do this layer setup in the future. Go to advanced drawing tool dialog again. So we flagpole. That's probably mostly tools for the side views of the map, which was also included in the original annual, but there's no tool for just a mouth in the overhead view. So we'll create a new one. Mast. We'll just call it mast pole. We'll perhaps add an overhead note to that, so we know it's in the overhead view, not in the side view. And we, as this will always be a circle, we can just make it a circle drawing tool. Well, the ellipse doesn't sound quite right, and for that we just click into options and set eccentricity to 1, and that will always make it a circle. Here we go. Let's check the properties. See, flex is wrong. It should go on the mask sheet as well on the layer masks. And we don't need the current color, we can just make it always black. Fill style is correct. Shouldn't have an outline, that's right. Okay. And now we have a drawing tool for our masks. Again, we can use the on modifier or the snap grid. And as you can see, there's already an effect set up for our masks casting a long shadow. And there's our masks. Now we do have a aft deck here, well, basically the raised rear part of the deck, where probably a captain's cabin and perhaps a cabin for some passengers or so is located underneath. And that's something we do need to show on the overhead main deck. So we could just put a different polygon with a different fill on the same sheet and everything, but we probably, because it's a bit higher, we want to show that with a little shadow and stuff, and so it's probably useful to put it on a new deck sheet. And for that we already have a new deck set up, and now another deck sheet, deck 2. See, here's that's some steps that are going up to the raised aft deck. And this is where we need to draw in our second deck again. And we can use our deck tool, but we do want to use a different. Perhaps we'll start off by using the same bitmap and perhaps just use the sheet effects to make it a little bit different in this map. So we can have the horizontal, the vertical pine deck again. But I do want it to be, it's a mirror drawing basically. I could of course trace again, but then it's a bit hard to make the line here through the center of the ship exactly vertical. So that's easier if we do it as a mirrored shape. So what I'm gonna do, I make a copy of the tool, vertical, and call it that mirrored. And make it the mirror tool again. Okay. And now I can start back here. And I'm going to follow my outline again. No, that's not right what I did there. So trace. Yeah, yes, that's better. And now I just go to the point where my vertical end of the raised deck is, and right click to finish. No, I need to finish my trace first. Again, left click to finish the trace, and then right click. And that did not work out as it should. What I'm doing wrong? Is the trace not working with the The mirrored tool, that might be happening. I've actually not tried to trace with the mirrored tool, and I might just have found a little glitch in the tools. Let's just have a look. Try this again. I start here and then want to trace my outline. And yes, as you can see, the mirror doesn't happen on the other side, which might can make makes of makes sense. So what we're gonna do instead, we're just gonna use the normal tool and use our snap grid. Not bother about exactly tracing, because we can just click a point below underneath our railing, and then we won't notice the snap that it's not exactly on the deck outline. And now the snap grid allows us to draw a vertical line exactly here. There we go. And now we're gonna trace the rest of the outline up here. There we go. See, it's a little bit off here. If you can see that, but since we're now gonna move the railing down here, so it shows above new deck sheet, the railing nicely hides that little oddity. And if we hide the temp sheet now for the moment, you can see that we have used the other orientation of the bitmap, which already sets this up quite nicely. It sets this off quite nicely from our main deck. But we could also now do stuff like modifying the deck tool here with, for example, matrix process. Give it a little bit of a different shading. Or we could add blend mode and darken it a little bit. Oh, that's more of a transparency. That's not what I wanted to do. Move up. Let's do it this way first. 100% darken. Okay. Okay, we've got some strange interactions between the glow and the blend mode here. Over here. Should probably ask Sue. She knows a lot more about blend mode and using it correctly than I do. So, let's try an RPG matrix process instead. Let's load something from our program data folder. System will start. Filters. Purple color matrix process. I thought I had a nice darkening matrix process. Yeah, there's one. That's the one I wanted. Yeah, you can see. And this is what I was looking for. See, now the wood bitmap is just a little bit darker than the other setting, and that way you can set these two off from each other, though probably a lighter one would be better at this point to show a higher elevation. So let's do that. Let's edit this, load and choose the lightened matrix. See, that's better. And then we're also gonna add a little shadow to this. So add Wall shadow, directional. You use the global sun direction, though all the shadows on the ship are in line. 50% is fine, but it should be fairly short, so it doesn't extend much into the water around. So let's make it a foot, and perhaps half a foot. Blur radius in map units. And there we have a little shadow here at the edge of our aft deck, showing that it's higher in elevation than our main deck. Okay, so and that's our next step, the aft deck, and we can continue drawing the parts we have on our construction image and adding more stuff like the hatch downwards, the stairs in here, the winch, putting up the sails, the anchor. We should probably have a nice symbol for an anchor. That's something that the old style is certainly lacking. We do have some cannon symbols. Well, this is just a merchant ship, so it wouldn't have any cannons. And you can add a wake and waves with the water tools around the ship. But this is, I think, is as far as we're gonna get today. I thought I might get a little bit further, but I realized this style does need a little more work in updating it and adding useful stuff than I thought. So I'm gonna deal with that and try to create a new, nice new annual issue from it with lots more useful tools and perhaps a few pre-drawn template hull shapes, so you can just select from different types of ships to fill them out with details, and we'll see what becomes of that. For tonight, thanks for joining me and following me along, and hope you enjoyed this, and see you again next week. All the best. Stay safe and healthy. Bye-bye.